by showing a little bit of a video, and you'll have to bear with me because when I practiced this, it was on a Windows computer, and this is a Mac, so I just need to do it slightly differently. I'm sorry. Maybe some of you have seen the film where Elsa is this ice princess, and in this song she describes her feelings in terms of cold and in terms of this storm. So she is she's describing her emotions. This is a bit small, but she's describing her emotions as cold and as a storm inside. So she's presenting herself as a container that is just full of this big storm. And that way of using metaphor, you draws on something we all know. So we all know what cold feels like, and we can imagine what it might be like to have a big storm inside. So that way we can kind of feel what she feels, maybe. So what I'll talk about today is what metaphor is and how it works, particularly in different health contexts. So I'll talk a little bit about pain, about COVID, mental health, and menopause. And then I'll talk a little bit generally about what that means for metaphor in health. And there's just a trigger warning, because when we talk about mental health, there'll be a little bit of a reference to self-harm. There's a little bit of, there's like an abstract depiction, and it'll be mentioned, so. But metaphor is to talk about one thing in terms of another, and maybe also to think about it like that. So the theory I'm using is based on the cognitive idea that metaphor carries over meaning from a source domain to a target domain. And if we think about the first metaphor here with Elsa, the source domain, it has to do with this cold weather, and the target domain is her emotions. So she's describing how she's feeling. What she's talking about is the target, and the words she uses to describe it is the source whenever we talk about metaphor. So the assumption here is that language is grounded in embodied experience. That's what makes metaphor, it's one of the things that can make metaphor efficient, is that it's based in something we all know, because we all have bodies, so there's a lot of things we have in common in that sense. I also use a critical metaphor analysis, which looks at also what metaphor does, what it's used for, who uses it, and how that feeds into different power structures, what it does for people. So the first example here is that we might talk about pain in terms of it being burning. Even if we haven't burned ourselves, we can still feel a burning pain. And that's a metaphor. it's quite common to talk about pain in this sense, so you also might talk about stabbing pain or splitting pain. That also refers to something that could have happened to you, but it hasn't necessarily, and when it hasn't, that's a metaphor. So there is some evidence that when you use these kind of metaphors, they might make people who listen to you more feel empathy for you, because they can maybe sense what burning or stabbing or splitting feels like. So So feeling this physical sensation is a shared human experience. So I'm sorry, I have to talk about COVID because I've worked on this PhD for the last 4 years and COVID has been part of it. So when COVID first hit or struck, it's hard not to talk about it in those kind of terms because it did feel like it had a very big impact on our lives. And in some, in a lot of countries around the world, it was talked about in terms of war. So war metaphors, they appear all sorts of places and they've been discussed a lot. Are they good? Are they bad? And there was a big discussion about, is it good to talk about this pandemic in terms of war? And some of the arguments that were made was that it's great to mobilize people and convey this sense of urgency that we need to do something and you need to do what the leaders tell you to do and that kind of thing. But after a while, it gets a bit tiring and people are not likely to keep on following the rules. If you keep saying, you know, it's a war, we have an enemy, we need to fight. So there were some researchers on Twitter who started discussing what other metaphors could we use to talk about COVID. And they did that using, you can see the little hashtag in the corner, reframe COVID. They used that hashtag to keep the discussion going about which other metaphors are used in your countries. And it kind of became a global discussion. And my supervisor and me, we started collecting all these examples in a spreadsheet and made it open for people to contribute. And lots of people did. And we had metaphors from all over the world describing COVID in other terms, terms that didn't have to do with war. So natural catastrophe. There were different kinds of natural catastrophes that was used a lot to describe COVID. So it could be things like we're all in the same boat in this storm, or we're in different boats because your boat is better than mine. And there's all these kind of different ideas about that it was this big overwhelming thing that we couldn't do anything about. And that was the problem that was criticized about some of these natural catastrophe metaphors, that if we describe it like that, then it doesn't matter what we do, because the storm's gonna get us, the water, we're gonna drown, there's nothing to do. So luckily, there was also metaphors that were a bit more useful. So if you think of the fire metaphor, there's a lot of, people know a lot about how you control a fire, what a fire needs. You can take away things that can burn, you can try and limit the oxygen, or you can put water on it. There's lots of like practical things. So maybe that's a better way of talking about COVID, at least that's what was argued. And then there was also people and animal metaphors. So the virus, so the pandemic was described as a person or like people or like animals. And also there was this idea from Norway, from a Norwegian newspaper, that we should all try and behave like hedgehogs. Just curl up in a little ball, wait for it to go to pass, and we'll all be fine. So that's my favorite COVID example. Finally, there were lots of sports and journey metaphors as well. So some of the sports metaphors are quite similar to war metaphors. You have an opponent, there's an element of competition if you're playing football or something like that. There's a winner and a loser. But there's also other kinds of sports. There's like a marathon has more to do with endurance. So that was also used. And then there's journey metaphors, which can be all sorts of different things. We walk together, we're sailing, we're on a train, and I'll give you a couple of examples of that in the following. So these were the metaphors that we saw most of in this COVID spreadsheet that we made with the help from a lot of people. So my supervisor and I, we then looked at some of the metaphors in the spreadsheet. So we looked at English, German, and Scandinavian metaphors, because those were the languages we could understand ourselves. I have to say, people were really good at putting in English translations as well. So even though there are examples from, I think it's 30 different languages. I can check that if anyone's curious. But people did put translations in. But we looked at the ones we were familiar with, and we found that a lot of them were used by politicians and media and so on, and had to do with getting people to do certain things. So this, of course, has to do with lockdown. You're trying to make people do something people don't want to do. It's not socially intuitive to withdraw like that, to that extent, and it's not good for the mental health. So it's natural, there's some resistance. So politicians use different metaphors to explain why some of these behaviors were encouraged. And so first of all, they tried to construe this we're in this together kind of idea. So the Danish Prime Minister said, we står på ubetrådt land, we stand on untrodden land, so an inclusive we stand together, and none of us knows, we don't know what this looks like. The British Prime Minister said, we've come through the peak, when he thought the worst of it was over. So again, we, you and me, all of us, we're all the same. They also appealed to perseverance. This is the example of the marathon from American newspapers and Swedish newspapers. Some of the metaphors were anticipating better times. So this example is from Britain as well, where the vaccines are portrayed as a train that's coming down the track, and we can see the lights of this train coming around the bend. So there is hope, we are going towards better times. There were also metaphors that tried to turn this difficulty of distance into something positive. So in Denmark, you had the slogan, vi står sammen hver for sig. So we stand together even though we are apart, or we hold together, or those kind of things were also used to get people to do what they wanted. And in general, what was done was to emphasize social cohesion rather than division. So kind of the opposite of what the war metaphors did, because war metaphors tend to focus very much on us and them. There's an opponent, and then there's me and my people were the good guys. Enough COVID, this sign, if you're not Danish, it has crossed out the part that has to do with keeping the distance because of COVID, and then we have a little heart instead, so let's move on. To mental health. And again, I'll just show a little video, so just bear with me. The video I show you, there'll be some metaphors in, and then I'll ask you which metaphors you see, just to check if you're still awake.
Pay attention now. Okay.
Sorry?
The masks.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so she's wearing a mask just before she falls down, and then when she's up and walking with her friend again, other people are wearing masks as well. And there's a big smile in this mask. Yeah. Nice. Yeah?
The drowning.
Yeah. I hadn't thought of it as drowning, but it could be drowning, yeah. She's definitely falling down from the top and falling down into something, and that could be water, definitely, yeah. Yeah.
That she turns into a bear.
Yeah.
And becomes back to a human when her friend's pulls her arm.
Yeah, exactly. So her friend, that was a bit difficult to see because of the bottom, but the friend is kind of stroking the bear, and then after the friend has like stroked the bear, she, like you say, she becomes a human again, and they start walking again, and she has her own face back. Yes.
Then there's literally that she's lost in the woods.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, a metaphor for being lost.
Yeah.
So that makes sense.
Definitely, yes, these dark woods, the way you can get lost, yeah.
Rather than being lost, I saw it as being isolated.
Yeah.
No one is around, you are literally in the forest where no one is. But, well, the same imagery.
Yeah. Well, you can read a lot of things into these woods, definitely. She's alone, she can get lost there, there's a hand in the back, yeah.
When she's falling, she has this spot of color on her knee, as if she's wounded.
Yeah. Definitely, yeah.
And there's the fact that everyone around her except her is without color.
Yeah.
It sort of looks like, I guess, sort of a newspaper-ish gray color. So everything's the same, everything is perhaps different from her, but everything's the same and she doesn't feel part of it.
Yeah, definitely. Yes.
Which is a great point, apart from the very end, where you see a few people adapting this red color, as to say that a lot of other people is carrying the same feelings that this person has.
Yeah, definitely. Great, that's fantastic. You found lots of things there in this.
You passed.
You all pass with flying colors. I wrote a few things on the slide, but you said more, and you were more, if I can get the slide back on. Yes. So you said more things, and you were more elaborate, so I'll leave it with that. The point is that watching something like that can convey an experience of mental health, and maybe create a better understanding between people who are experiencing it and other people who are watching videos like this. There's other videos on YouTube as well about different mental health conditions, and there's some really good ones out there. It's really interesting. So yeah, you've covered this and said even more. So we'll move on to menopause. Because that's my PhD topic. So I have looked at how metaphors are used to describe menopause, and I found that they're used mostly to share experiences, to explain problems and solutions connected to menopause, to seek to persuade someone to change behavior, and to endow bodily processes with agency. So you've seen the first three ones already in the other metaphors I've talked about already. So I'll give you a couple of examples from my data.
Sorry, just to clarify, when exactly does menopause occur?
So it varies a bit, but it happens on average when you're around 50, 51. And then people who have it earlier than 45, they have early menopause. And there's stories of girls experiencing it before they hit puberty, or where it kind of coincides with puberty almost. So it varies a lot. But for the vast majority, it's kind of in the late 40s, early 50s. So, all right. Thank you. So in this one, it's... it's an article from a women's magazine, and it's a story about someone, a famous person who has experienced menopause. And it tells a little story where she, the woman has found her own way. So she kind of found her own solution and to menopause. And what I find interesting about this example is you've got her body as the agent. Her body takes a ride in this roller coaster. It's not something she does, but it's something her body does on its own. And you have it, it's a hormonal roller coaster. So you also have hormones being able to create a roller coaster, which I also think is an interesting metaphor, because that is, that it kind of depicts the ups and downs that you can feel going through menopause. And then we have a very classic one, that she was struck by menopause. And we saw that with COVID as well. COVID struck, co-founded. So yeah, so they're very classical. Then this one is from, so I'm looking at both Danish and US American data. And this one I've taken from a website called the Mayo Clinic, which is a medical website. And it constructs, again, something that goes on in a woman's body, so signs and symptoms, as being able to talk to the woman. So they can tell her something. And then there's a test that she can take that can also tell her something. But that is described as not being as reliable as what her body can tell her. So you've got this medical website saying, listen to your body instead of getting this test. Then there's an example here from a Danish medical website, Sundhed.dk, where the bothers, the troubles, the unpleasant experiences you have during menopause, they are constructed as being able to leave and come back. So they are able to move by themselves. So this is the kind of metaphor, you read through text like that and you don't even notice it's a metaphor, but when you think about it, then that's what's happening. And then finally, there was mixed metaphors as well, where there's this description, you can tailor your diet and exercise regime to combat most of these alterations. So first we're talking about tailoring, adapting something, maybe clothes, and then it turns into a physical fight. And then we end up in the world of sports. So metaphors can kind of interact together, even though they come from very different source domains, they can work together in this way. So overall, what I found both at looking at other people's work on metaphors in health and what I found myself is that metaphors in health are great to make something that's invisible, to make it visible, to describe difficult experiences, to find strength. Sometimes these war metaphors or combat metaphors are used to empower ourselves and feel like, okay, I'm going to keep fighting, this is hard, but I'll keep fighting. To achieve understanding between people, like we saw particularly with the mental health video, and to persuade people to change behavior. Metaphors can be very persuasive as well. So, thank you very much. And I just want to mention that I'm, well, and I already mentioned I'm at Lancaster University, but I want to mention this network as well, because it's fabulous. It's Scandinavian metaphor researchers, and there's a blog there, so you can read about different researchers' work on metaphor, and I recommend that. So it's called mednetscandinavia.com. Thank you. Any questions?
So you mentioned that there were a lot of common sort of metaphors used. Did you notice anyone that were the most kind of common to describe menopause?
So I found quite a few of these kind of violence ones. So I found a more variety in the American ones in terms of violence, but I also found this hun blev ramt af overgangsalderen.
Struck.
So struck, exactly. So you had the roller coaster slide. And that is used both in English and in Danish. So I think, but that's what I find in most literature metaphor is that violence and war, they are just used a lot. So, yeah.
Are the metaphors for menopause generally negative?
That's a really good question. It varies a lot. So there are some negative ones. Then you sometimes have a negative one followed up by a text saying, but it doesn't have to be that way. Or it's not like that for most women. Some women experience this, and then there's a horrible metaphor, and then, but most don't. But yes, I would say a lot of the figurative language is kind of negative.
You looked at this, were your data only on real life, or was it also on, for example, pop culture?
So I've looked at I don't know if women's magazines is real life. I think that's it's like but I get your question.
Yeah.
I haven't looked at pop culture, and the examples I've taken from other people's work. So I suppose the film on mental health is the more creative, in the more creative genre. But then otherwise people have looked at metaphor in how people talk online about various health conditions. And I looked at women's magazines and then these medical websites where doctors have described what they think women need to know or questions they have frequently asked and that kind of thing. So it's real life in that sense, that it's the real internet.